Does your law firm sometimes pay in advance for items or services that they use to service clients? Well, then you need to know how to allocate client costs and prepaid expenses. If you have any questions about this topic, you can leave them in the comments section below and I'll do my best to help you. And of course, if you feel the video helped you, I hope you will click like and don't forget to subscribe to get updates on new videos that come out all the time. We don't always know which clients will need the resources that we pay for and record as expenses. This is the case if we pay client-related expenses before using them. At the moment we pay, we don't yet know which client the service or asset will be used for. We will know how much of each prepaid resource is used for a particular client only at the moment the item is actually used. And unfortunately, most states require that you apportion or allocate even the prepaid costs to your clients for what was used. Some examples of prepaid costs and job expenses would be paying a car service in advance for a set number of rides that you will use to go to or service your clients. Paying rent several months in advance of actually staying in an office or some place that you rent. Paying an insurance policy up front before the coverage starts is also an example of a prepaid cost or expense. Or prepaying a repair service contract with a tech company who promises to come in the future after the payment and fix your computers as needed. So these are typical prepaid expenses that you would have to apportion to clients. Now, all prepaid services and resources are current assets at the moment we purchase them. They become expenses at the moment that we use them. And when we use them, we record a transaction in the write checks window, and that's a workaround that only attorneys have to use in QuickBooks Desktop to move the item from asset to expense for whatever was used for that particular client. For example, at the moment you pay for anything, you have an asset, and then as you use the value, the amount you use goes from asset to expense. So if you purchased supplies in advance, at the moment you purchase the supplies, you have an asset. Then over time, as you use the supplies, the amount of supplies you use becomes supplies expense, and the asset value is decreased by the amount that you used. Same thing with prepaid insurance. When you pay the policy up front, you have an asset. Then as time goes by, you have to adjust for the amount of the policy you used over time, and the amount of the policy that you used over time becomes insurance expense. Same thing if you pay your rent in advance on the office. As you stay in the office, the asset that you paid for the value of staying in the apartment or office, gets used over time as you stay, and the amount that you used and actually stayed for becomes rent expense. Now, in our example, we're imagining that on March 25th, we paid Staples $300 with check number 3 for office supplies. We do not yet know which clients these expenses will be applied to. Let's record this purchase into the current asset called supplies. Okay, but now here's the thing. In QuickBooks Desktop, we have to do a workaround to handle these prepaid expenses. So we're not going to make it current asset type. We're going to make all of our prepaid expenses a bank type of account. It's still a current asset, but by making it specifically a bank type of account instead of a general current asset, we will have the ability to make a separate transaction at the moment we use the service or the value. So this technique allows us to do this very smoothly in QuickBooks Desktop. So we click Banking, Write a Check, and we put the date March 25th of 2021, and we're purchasing it from, I guess, Staples. So if Staples is not on the list, you can very easily click Add New, Vendor. Okay, and it's $300. And it's a current asset called supplies. But when we add it to our chart of accounts, we're going to do the workaround and make it a bank type of account. It's still a current asset listed in the same places, but it gives us the ability to do the workaround and bill the client for specific supplies that we will use in the future. Save and close, and then of course, save and close your check window, and then when you open your trial balance, you can see that it's in the position of a current asset on the debit side, $300 for supplies. Now when we continue in the same example, let's imagine on April 2nd, an associate lawyer used $50 of these supplies that we purchased on March 25th, and we used it for client Betty Boop. What will be the result in the trial balance at the moment we use $50 of these supplies? Well, supplies, the asset, is going down, because we have less of the value of supplies if we used some. And supplies expense, which is the amount we actually expended, will increase in our chart of accounts because we now have an expense for the value that we used. So what will be the result? Supplies will become 250. You see, right now it's 300, but it will become 250 because we just used $50 of supplies, and at the moment we use these supplies, supplies expense will show up in the trial balance for $50. Let's go ahead and record the fact that we use this on April 2nd for Betty Boop. We again click Banking, Write a Check. We make the date April 2nd, but now here's the workaround. The value is coming from the supplies account, and it's going to supplies expense. And if you don't have supplies expense on your list, you would have to click Add New, Expense, and type in supplies expense. I happen to already have it as an expense type of account representing what we used. Now, we don't put a payee because there is no payee. We put the money amount of the supplies that was actually used on April 2nd, and most importantly, we have to put which particular client the supplies were used for. That gives us the ability to apportion this after we purchased it. So when we click Save and Close and we come back to the trial balance, you can see the numbers are exactly as what we expected. The supplies went down to 250, and the supplies expense showed up for the first time as $50. Now, the most important report to check after you do this is the profit and loss by job. So if we click profit and loss by client, we can see that this specific $50 of supplies expense is only in the column of Betty. We needed to use $50 of supplies for Betty, lowering our profit for Betty Boop the client by $50. Now let's do a second example. Let's imagine on April 6, we purchased $200 of stamps from the United States Post Office. We paid with cash from the Chase Bank debit card, and they gave us receipt number 1234567 that we taped on the box to specifically identify which purchase the stamps came from. So what will be the result in the trial balance at the moment we pay in advance for this postage? Well, the asset called prepaid postage would increase because it shows up for the first time, because we just purchased a current asset because we paid in advance and we don't yet know which clients the stamps will be used for. And of course, the bank account will decrease by the $200 because we just bought stamps and paid the money. But don't forget our attorney workaround in QuickBooks Desktop. When we buy this prepaid asset, we have to make it specifically a bank type of account so our workaround will work smoothly and we'll be able to apply it to a future client's job. From the main menu, we click Banking, Write a Check. The date is April 6th. Make sure you're paying from the correct operating bank account, and we're paying the United States Post Office $200. Now, we're paying for prepaid postage. So, we come down here, and because it's not on the list, we click Add New, and don't forget the workaround. We make the prepaid expenses a bank type of account. And we click Save and Close. So we're paying in advance $200 for postage that we will use for a future client. So we can click Save and Close. And when we open the trial balance, you can see the bank account decreased by the $200 and the prepaid postage showed up for the first time as $200. Now, let's continue the example and imagine on April 7th, an office administrator used $25 of the stamps purchased on March 7th with that receipt number for things they needed to service this specific client, Candy Charles. So what will be the result in the trial balance when we now use $25 worth of the stamps? Well, the prepaid postage will go down by the amount that we used because that asset is no longer worth $200 because we just used $25 worth. And postage expense will show up for the first time in the amount that we used. And what will happen is that this prepaid postage will become $175, and postage expense will show up in the trial balance for the very first time as $25. So this is how we will record using the prepaid postage. We click Banking, Write a Check, and we put the proper date that we actually used it, but the money is coming from prepaid postage, and the money is going to postage expense. If you don't have postage expense on the list, you'll have to add it and make it an expense type of an account. Now, the amount that we used was $25. There's no payee when you use an item, but you must identify the specific client that you applied the postage to. And in this case, it's Candy Charles. Now, we don't want it billable. We'll learn how to bill the client for these prepaid expenses later by just clicking the check mark when we learn more about billables. But right now, don't let it click the check mark. We just want to click Save and Close so that when we look at our trial balance, we can see the result is exactly as what we need. Prepaid postage is now the amount that reflects the value that's on hand, and postage expense only reflects what we actually used. But the most important thing to look at is the profit and loss by client. You can see that this $25 of postage expense that we used is only in the column of Candy Charles. So that's the workaround, the method, and the technique of applying prepaid costs to future clients' jobs. Now let's close this out by using the remaining supplies and postage. Let's imagine also on April 7th, we used $250 of supplies and $200 of postage for an office party not related to any specific client. And what will happen after these two transactions? Well, both the prepaid postage will go down to zero, and it will all go into postage expense, and the supplies will go down to zero because we used all of them, and they will all go to supplies expense, and the IRS doesn't need to know that it was for a party. But we need to know that it's not for any specific client. So that should be easy. Banking, write a check. The date is already April 7th. The prepaid postage, the remaining amount of prepaid postage is $175. And we're not going to put party as the payee, but we will put postage expense, but we will not put a customer or client. We will simply click save and close. And you can see in the trial balance that prepaid postage is wiped out and it all became the expense. Banking, write a check. Same thing. Supplies, the balance of supplies is $250. It all becomes supplies expense. So we click save and close. And you can see the results in the trial balance are exactly as what we expected. Supplies and prepaid postage are zero, and the total amounts are now expenses. But most importantly, you can see that it is proper that they have not been tracked to any specific client.